So, welcome back, everybody. Now, this isn't Eric and Chad, this is Sam and Tom, and we had a lot of requests from you guys to show you our armoury, and, well, my armoury, and to be honest, kind of mostly Tom's armoury, really,
yes,
because
definitely.
He's a bit of a collector.
Yes.
Obviously, all my rifles and shotguns are pretty much hunting related. Tom's got a lot of more target stuff and hunting stuff. So, yeah, let's crack on. To start with, unlicensed. We have here my Air Arms S310 in 2.2. Oh, you can get yours out.
Yeah, mine out as well. Let's compare sizes.
Bolt action. Rotary 10-shot magazine. And I haven't got the silencer on this at the moment, but I know it's clear. There's a bit of gas in it. So I'll just let them off. You can see it's a bit of a bang. And yeah, I just use this around barns really, shooting like collared doves and feral pigeons and rats and stuff like that. I must admit, there is something not quite right with this rifle. It's not shooting quite as accurately as it should be, so I probably need to do something with it. I know, to be fair, I bought this when I was 17.
Which
makes it, what, 20 years old? Yeah, it does. 27,
aren't we?
Yeah. And I left it at my dad's when I left home, and then he just chucked it in the shed, basically, for several years. And when I got it back, it was covered in rust, and it was just completely screwed.
It was broken when it went in there as well, wasn't it?
Well, I never just needed new seals.
Yeah, well.
It wasn't broken.
You weren't shooting it, though, were you?
No, but you couldn't. Yeah, you couldn't fill it.
I remember.
It just needed new O-rings, and that's quite common. I mean, that's just a normal maintenance thing, really. But when I got it back, it was just completely buggered, to be honest. It was all rusty. So I actually sent it off in the end to the Air Arms factory, and it cost me about 180 quid actually at the time. And they put a new cylinder on it, and it's an S410 cylinder, and you can tell that because the cap is a screw-on cap, and it's got this sort of T style of valve on it. And yeah, I had it back and I used it, but like I said, it's never quite been the same. When I had it brand new, it was like a tap driver. So I don't know whether to sell it or what, or just try and get it working.
Well, it does have a lot of sentimental value for you though, doesn't it? That was your first gun.
Well, it wasn't, but it was my...
No, it was the one that was yours.
The first one I bought.
You bought that brand new. I remember you saved up, what was it, about 600 quid?
Yeah.
And back then, that was like getting on for a month's wage. It was a month's wages, probably. Well, at least
less,
for us.
A bit less. But not far off.
It was a big thing. You drove all the way to Evesham, even though we've got a gun shop in Worcester. But
yeah, well, not a very good gun shop in Worcester.
No, I think they're rubbish.
I
disagree. They have guns. So, good guns.
In Worcester.
Anyway,
that's this really. It's all right. It's a pretty good gun. It originally was amazingly accurate. I'm not sure what to do about this now, whether to sell it or not, but we shall see. Anyway, that's that. Obviously, Tom's got his...
Got my Diana.
Diana P1000.
Which I didn't pay a single penny for. Which is my favourite price.
Yes.
I've had this, couple of years now, I think. Not shot it a huge amount, because, unfortunately, at the moment, I didn't seem to get hardly any time to go shooting. Which is, of course, completely pants. However, it is a lovely thing.
And that's the one you won in the competition, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah. Weighs an absolute ton, though.
It is, yeah. It's
a
very,
really,
very
really heavy gun.
It does seem to be a bit of a tap driver, though.
Oh, God, yeah.
And it does... Initially, you look at it and you think that this is like a copy of the Wyrock HW100, because it's very similar. In fact, the cylinder and screws out, which I think the early Wyrocks did. I'm not sure.
No, I don't think they did. I'm not sure, you know.
Well, anyway, it is quite similar, but there are, if you actually get into detail, there are a few sort of fair... differences.
Quite rare as well, because they haven't didn't sell many into the UK. When they launched it, I had to wait nearly 2 years to get this after winning the competition.
Yeah.
When they launched it, they didn't send it through the proof house like they should have. And I think there was loads of problems with them as well. First ever PCP gun from Diana, it's going to be amazing, the quality is going to be so good. Yeah, and they ballsed up a little bit.
Yeah.
And it failed the proof test. So they had to go back to the drawing board and re-released it again, and by that time everyone had just lost confidence massively in this country, certainly.
Yeah.
And you don't really see them, and you don't see them with a thumb hole either, which they don't sell, you can't buy them.
Well, I can certainly say that every video I've done on the P1000 has been really popular.
It has, hasn't it? Yeah.
So I don't know.
I'm a bit precious about it though.
He's very precious about it.
New air gun. I've never had a new air gun before.
I do actually want to do a review on this rifle at some point, and as the spring comes and we get some lighter evenings, I probably will. And
if I let you, Sam.
That's if he lets me. Yes, but I want to take it down the range, and to get down the range, it needs to be really in when it's lighter in the evening, so I can get down there when there's no one about, because otherwise there's too much gunfire around and it ruins the video, really.
Yeah.
But that will be on the cards at some point, and it's been a long time coming, let's face it.
Yes, it has.
So anyway, that's that.
So, I'll let you know.
Yes. Going on to section two. This is my Browning 525. Not an awful lot to say about this, really. It's got a dirty barrel. Oh, you probably can't see that, but it's got a dirty barrel at the moment from shooting pheasants at the weekend. And I bought this at Ian Coley's in Cheltenham, and it's been a pretty good gun, but it doesn't fit me terribly well. Hence the reason why I've now got this butt pad on it. It's not because of recoil, it's because it gives me a bit of extra length of pull. So when I get behind it, I've got more cant in the stock because of that extra length. And that allows me to sort of get onto target with it a bit better. But I have killed many beasts with it. You know, this has been a great gun, to be honest. I've killed so many things with this. It's been a good gun. And as you've seen recently, I've been shooting pheasants a lot with it. Obviously, I do have a Section 1 shotgun. Can't use those against game. So this really still has a strong purpose for me. So I use it a lot. That's Tom's Browning Satori. It's down. And that's basically, it's basically a Browning 525 as well, isn't it?
Yeah, it's just, underneath it is the same thing, really.
Yeah, the engraving's slightly different,
yeah.
The wood's a bit different to my gun. It's a little bit cheaper. But it's basically the same, and...
It didn't cost less than yours, didn't it?
No, it didn't, but it looks cheap.
Actually, no, it did. only by a very small amount.
Yes, yeah.
Very small amount.
But the quality of the engraving I don't think is quite as nice, and I don't think the quality of the wood's quite as nice, personally. But yeah, a great gun. It does the job. Both got the Invector Plus choke system, which my Winchester uses as well. And
my Maxis.
Yes, well, yeah. Yes. So you can't go wrong with it, really. And it's nice to be able to sort of chop and change a little bit as and when, to be honest, between guns and chokes. Because otherwise, you know, chokes are actually really expensive. So having one set of chokes you can use for lots of different guns is very useful, to be honest.
I shoot quite well with that, though. Shoots a bit high for me. But I generally use this on clays mostly, I say it before, but it's been out pigeon shooting.
Yeah,
hasn't killed anywhere near as much stuff as yours, but
yes,
certainly killed a lot more clays.
Yeah, that is actually probably more to do with the amount of ammunition I've been firing for it rather than accuracy. But then,
I remember when we first started out, was it 80 shots for five? And I fired about 24, and I shot. Four.
Yeah. Well, yeah, okay. Yeah, that wasn't the greatest ratio, but we had a lot of fun.
We did have an enormous amount of fun, actually, in the early days of pigeon shooting.
I remember the first time we did that, we were using plastic walls as well, and it was just like a sea of plastic walls ahead of us, in front of the
light. It's pretty bad.
Yeah, you just want to shoot them at like 60, 70 yards and stuff, so it wasn't the best. But,
no,
it
was...
You live and learn.
Oh, to be fair, you probably watch a video of that.
You probably
doing it,
You looked at my back catalogue, I'm sure you've seen that. Anyway, moving on to section... One. Oh no, you've got some more section two to show.
Oh, bloody hell, yeah.
Yes.
About that one. Yeah. Just very quickly.
Your Maxis.
Yeah. Oh, this is a good gun.
Now, this is actually, as some of you guys will have noticed, there is a new version of this that's just come out.
Which I haven't seen yet.
No, Tom hasn't seen it. I only just told them about it. But
interesting new gun.
Yeah, absolutely. But it's a great gun. You know, it's obviously self-loading. 2+1. It's... low recoil. I mean, I'm not a fan.
This is my best, favourite pigeon gun. If I want to have a really good day on the pigeons, make sure I hit everything.
That's your shooting
gun. That's my shooting gun,
But, from my perspective, it just doesn't suit my style. I don't like this sort of mechanical movement as I'm firing. I'd actually personally prefer a pump. But it is a great gun. It's an interesting design. The forend actually kind of covers the mag tube. So it's sort of
strip it down really easily.
So
take that out.
It's it's quite interesting.
That just comes straight off.
And of course, it does have that quite new. Well, I don't think it's unique anymore, but a fairly unique thing where basically, if the bolt's back and it's empty, and you just feed it round from the magwell underneath, it'll automatically chamber that round. Obviously, normally with a semi-auto, you run it dry. You turn the gun over, you drop one in, press the button, close the bolt, and then feed them in. But that will just do all of that for you. So that's quite useful.
I didn't like that. Pigeon shooting, yeah. It pointed upwards.
Yeah.
And just keep feeding like that, rather than have to, especially when we share a hide, yeah, having to wave your gun around, especially a semi-auto that you can't break, it's a bit unsafe.
Yeah.
So to be able to just keep it constantly up in the air and flicking cartridges in.
Well, also, it's a rule of thumb, and I believe...
That's what we do.
As a rule of thumb, and I believe this is why with Section 2, you have three shots rather than two in a gun like that, is because the idea is, you put three in it, you fire two shots, and then it's ready to go, and you just put another two in, and you just use it like that. Mm. But obviously that allows you to properly use the third shot and just keep on feeding it. So,
yeah,
it's a cracking gun.
I'm sure there's been pigeons off shot because I've managed to load it so quickly.
Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah.
Rather than faffing around.
But Ed's gun, I found that a real faff. Was it a Beretta A400?
Oh, Explore Action.
Yeah, yeah, really, really nice quality gun. Oh, we've done a quick review of that as well, actually.
Yeah,
that was one of the first videos we did, actually.
Yeah, it's got a digital readout on
lovely,
the
lovely, lovely thing, but... Very just true. A faff I found to load and shoot. You always have to put one in the chamber. You can't put one in the mag racket. It didn't seem to work like that.
Yeah, and it's got a funny thing on the stock that makes it move. He's a bit of a pussy on his shoulder and he can't. Yeah.
And he does have quite a large head.
And he will kill him when he sees me. Yeah. If I say that, because he'll go, no, I'm injured. Yeah,
well, although, no, your head is about the same size.
Also very large.
Anyway, so that's a great gun too. Again, taking
my first shotgun. That was actually.
Oh, it was, yeah.
I drove. It was something like an hour and 20 minute journey to the gun shop to buy this. And I said, I'm all excited. Bristol, yeah. All excited. Get my first gun in my van. Bombing down the motorway. About an hour into the journey, I realised I've forgotten my shotgun certificate.
Yeah, that's a bit of a problem.
I turn around, come back, another hour.
I think I
pick up my shotgun certificate, drive back and buy it.
I think I was the one who talked you to buying that.
Yeah, it's when I bought Egg from there, I think.
Because you were buying an AirArms S310.
Yeah, yeah.
I'll bear in mind, guys, by the way, we've shown our air guns. We picked one each. I mean, I've only got one. Tom's got like a million. And so I said, just pick one, because otherwise this video is going to go on for too long. But he does also have an AirArms S310 in 177 calibre, which he bought at the same time as that. Anyway,
quickly.
Oh, yeah, but shoot me in the head. Yeah.
20 more, there's that as well. You've seen that recently.
Yeah, in 20 more.
Big video on that. Cheap gun. Get rid of it soon, probably.
Yes, not the best.
not mine, Laura's.
Yes, not
the
actually
best. Actually, my gun, so.
So, moving on to section one. And our 2-2 rimfires. This is my Browning T-Bolt in 2-2. As many of you have seen, it's got a 10-shot double helix designed rotary magazine, so it's a bit different to, say, the Ruger 1022. And it's great because it means 10 shots and it's flush with the gun. And it's obviously a straight pull, so you don't have to pull the bolt up, you just back and forth and carry on firing. That's useful because it means that you can shoot the gun, and after you've... I don't normally dry fire, but I'll dry fire it. That safety offer to help. And then when you rack it back and forth, you don't count the gun. With a bolt action, you have a tendency, when you pull the bolt up, to go like this.
Mm.
And then when you do that, when you come back up, you've then got to re-find the target. But because it's straight ball, you can stay on target. So, this has been a cracking little gun.
Yeah, you do. You definitely do.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So, there is a distinct advantage, but the only trouble is, the reason why you don't see many of guns with this design, or rifles with this design, is there's also a slight disadvantage. And the disadvantage is that you can't have a particularly light trigger. I mean, this trigger goes down to about £4, and there's no drop-in kits or anything like that, so you're kind of stuck with it, really. But, you know...
I'm not a big fan of it.
Yeah, I know. I mean, I know Tom doesn't like it, but for me, I get used to it. And when I'm hunting with it, I really don't notice. I mean, I really don't. Only target shooting it becomes an issue. If I'm trying to shoot a rabbit in the head, I mean, you saw last week, outlamping, I wasn't in the head, to be fair, it was more in the spine. But I shot a rabbit quite easily with a lamp at 70 yards, and that was, not for very good rest.
I can watch that, yeah, actually.
No.
Funny enough.
Because your broadband's not very good.
Yeah, it's my tin sensor rubbish. So I can't watch Sam's videos unless I go to Sam's house.
Yes.
Where he makes his videos.
Yes.
It just seems a bit silly, really. All these people around the world can watch them. Yeah. I can't.
Yeah, there we are. So that's the Browning T-Bolt. And that's topped off with an MTC Mamba scope, which I think's 4 to 16 magnification. Yeah. Cracking scope. And if I'm honest, it's a bit overkill. Because I never really use more than about 5 times zoom, but... There we are. This is Tom's CZ452?
Yes.
Is it? Yeah.
Yes.
And You've done a fair bit of target shooting with it, but not so much hunting.
No, again, another time restriction.
Yeah.
Because of my need to be employed. The job I do, unfortunately, has very, very antisocial hours, so...
But it does have a cracking silencer on it, if you look at the size of that bin.
It's quite heavy, but...
with the right ammo,
certainly effective.
It makes it very, very quiet indeed. And because, you know, if you look at the size of that, it's almost excessive, really, for a 2.2 rimfire, but it's...
good little gun, though.
Yeah, it does the job.
Bolt action. I've only got a 5-shot mag for it. Fortunately, I bought a 10-shot mag, then lost it. Then found it again, and then lost it properly again.
That's
how I used it, which is frustrating.
But it does weigh a ton. That's the only thing.
It's quite heavy, but it's quite short. It is quite short.
Yeah.
But the trigger is lovely on this.
It is always a catch 22 though, really. I mean, if you take this rifle, if I'm honest, this gun is so light, because I mean, it's got a plastic lower on it, and it's so light that the fact I have a camera on here, you can see this is on here to put the camera on, the camera actually makes me shoot it a lot more accurately. So when I'm on the bench and I don't have the camera on it, I can't shoot it as well. And so you've got a gun like that, and it's got a lot more weight to it, it does help a lot with accuracy. But then, it's annoying to carry around for hours on end in the field. So, you know, it swings and roundabouts, really, to be honest.
Mind you, I reckon if I took the bipod off this and put your moderator on it, say, which is quite a light moderator, it would be somewhere near what yours is.
I
definitely. It'd
still be a bit heavier.
Not by a lot.
A lot more steel than that.
I don't know what the actual weights are, but...
No.
But yeah, it's a good little gun, though. A
lot more steel in it.
These are great for if you want a first gun. It's a cheap gun as well.
It's like £200.
250 quid with pretty much everything you see here. which I thought was quite reasonable. I had to drive a fair distance to go and buy it, but certainly worth it. Not used it much though, do some plinking with it. It's one of those guns though, when you've got all this other stuff that you shall see shortly, and you think, why would you want to shoot that? A little 2.2 at paper targets. But when you do actually get down the range and start blinking, it is a lot of fun still. We still enjoy it.
Yeah.
Even the smaller calibers, even occasionally get the air rifles out.
Yeah, it's a cracking little gun. I mean, I must admit, I'm not a big fan of punching paper, really. Not other than just to practice to shoot rabbits.
I could just shoot anything, Dave, personally, if you know.
Anyway.
Money and time would allow me.
Anyway, moving on into centre fire now, I think. Although, oh no, we've got some more shotguns to look at, actually. Let's look at the shotguns.
What are we doing? We're doing shotguns.
So we're not very well organised, as you can probably gather.
No, not really.
If I look at this. Oh. Again, you guys will be familiar with this. This is my Winchester SXP, and at the moment, it's got a Nordic Arms +1 extension. So this actually holds 7 rounds, 6+1, but I do have another extension on it, which means it holds 10+1. And I originally bought this just for a bit of a laugh, a practical shotgun, to be honest. It was only £300.
It was not a lot of money.
But what I soon discovered, although it's a bit short, like pretty much all pump saws, I've had to put this on it. It actually, for me, fits me incredibly well because I've got lots of cans in the stock to accommodate my huge neck. And it's got a nice raised rib, so I can just shoulder this and I'm right on it. And as some of you will have seen, this summer, during the sun season, I was using this loads. It was my go-to gun, really, is Thomas said, my shooting gun.
Yeah,
and you know, a lot of you guys are saying, oh, why don't you take out the Browning? And I do. If I'm honest, if I'm shooting pigeons over decoys, this is the thing to take.
You hit more with that, definitely.
I hit a lot more.
You hit, like, if you took that on the glaze, you would destroy what you've been doing on your 5.
Oh, I'm sure I would. Yeah. But the thing is, added
that's
to that...
That's fit, though.
Yeah, exactly.
If you had your 5.25 fitted and have a couple of lessons, I reckon you'd be right on the money with that.
Oh, I'm sure I would, but the point is that it fits me, but also it's waterproof. It takes the same chokes as my Browning 5.25, so I can swap them around, because again, it's part of the it's FN, isn't it? They're the same group. And it holds a high capacity, so that's really useful. You know, when you're in the hide, you don't have to reload particularly often. So yeah, this has been a great little gun, to be honest, especially for £300. It's been a real asset, to be honest. Now, Thomas here has got his...
another pumper. Two car pumpers.
That's your Mossberg 600.
Yes.
AT. And again, you would have seen a review of this that we did a couple of years ago now.
Oh, I love that sound.
Yeah. Obviously, it's basically a Mossberg 500 that most of you will be familiar with. But it was released, I think, for, was it Walmart or some sort of department store?
No, it wasn't Walmart. No, it's a department store. I don't think they're around anymore.
Okay. Well, anyway, they released it for a department store.
And it was the New Haven 500 by Mossberg.
That's right. It was the New Haven.
Exclusive to them.
No, it was the New Haven 600AT, wasn't it?
Yeah.
That's right.
I think so,
So, and a lot of people now colloquially call it the Mossberg 600.
But well, there are different versions of the 600, because you could have a 600 New Haven with plus four or plus five instead of plus seven.
That's right.
And different length barrels and different spec.
So it's a bit more luxurious. It's more luxurious than your standard 500, because as standard it comes with a little bit higher capacity. And you've also got the select choke system on
right at the end.
It's that weird ball.
I'm sort of getting on with it now. We do need to pattern test that though.
I know.
Because I reckon it'd be rubbish.
I think it would.
Because it's like a spiral of metal that you squeeze together. Well, restrict it.
Well, effectively, the end of the barrel will be cut.
Yeah.
And it just squeezes the barrel in, basically. So that can't be good.
It can't be good for patterning, no. But to be fair, for practical, I don't know how important the patterning is, really.
Steel plates,
if they are a particularly long way away, but, you know, I'm not doing massive competitions.
No, absolutely.
It's club, at a club level at the moment.
Yeah.
Which I got a third overall in class for in 2014, I believe, which I'm very proud of.
I sort of do it for a laugh now and again, if I'm honest, and then just basically make an arse of myself.
Yeah.
Sometimes I do. I think it's like I hit everything, and sometimes I'm really quick, but then I'll always break some rules of some sort.
I think you have most amount of penalties if I hit.
I have on some sort
didn't
of...
Didn't put your foot on the cone for eight targets, I think it was.
Yeah,
it was very funny. I was behind him laughing.
And that was the whole course, and that was an official nationwide competition.
But did you have fun, Samuel?
Yes, well, I did have fun until I had... what's his name? Pat taking the piss out of me for it. But he's great at that. But it's great.
Oh, we all took the piss out.
I mean, we always talk about Practical Shotgun being great for having a laugh. It's sort of great camaraderie and it's a bit of fun, isn't it, on a Sunday? So it's just nice.
It is,
now and again.
The banter's very good. Actually.
And our club's great because they don't take it too seriously.
No.
And I get this a lot of subscribers asking me, it was the same with clay shooting as well. I mean, you know, what sort of score should I get before I enter a competition? It's just like, why do you care? Just have a laugh.
Mm.
You know, if you are at a club where people are going to look down their nose at you for not being great in a competition, well, excuse my French, but fuck that club, it's crap. And go somewhere else, because you want to go somewhere where there's nice people who just don't mind you having a bit of a laugh, really. Don't you think?
Yeah, well, it is, for some people, it's just purely competitiveness, which you obviously, you're not really competitive. It's all about hunting with you, pretty much.
Yes.
Some people, I'm a little bit more competitive. Getting that third place.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Gave me a big.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with that. Just don't diss somebody if they're not.
No, certainly not. No, never discourage people from shooting.
Absolutely.
Shooting's amazing. Everyone's great shooting.
Yes.
Right now.
So I think you should get your new Benelli out. Now, I've only actually seen this for the first time today. This is another Section 1 shotgun.
This is my new gun.
The Supernova.
Yeah.
And I must admit,
I've been looking for one of these for ages.
It does handle very well. I think for pigeons, I would like an extra couple of inches, like 26 inch barrel rather than a 24. With my Winchester, 26 is perfect because even though that is a bit short, when you've got obviously all this stuff in the way that extends the length of the gun like it would with any pump or semi, 26, it gives you just about the right length. Well, that seems that it feels a bit short to me, but then.
I think I'd shoot pigeons all right with that one, so it's got to be iron, I don't think about that much difference.
But
this is purely a practical gun. I will take it on the pigeons.
Well, yeah, but I think the Benelli, to be honest, is a steal. Because brand new, you're talking, what, 500 quid?
I think it might be 600. I think it's about £610.
Okay, but that's still substantially cheaper than buying a semi-auto.
And, yeah, it is. Yeah.
And second-hand, you can pick them up for obviously a lot cheaper than that. And they really are fantastically well engineered. It's a very, very nicely made gun. Compared to this Winchester, because like I said, I love this gun, don't get me wrong. But, you know, when I've been shooting for a while, for a start, the mag tube, this will loosen. Even though I should have a clamp on it, to be honest. I don't bother because it gets in the way, you know, in terms of my sight picture. But this will loosen, and the stock here sometimes will cant a little bit to the side. It gets loose, and I have to, like, bend it back into the right place, you know. It is a bit of a crappy Turkish-made gun, and sometimes there are certain channels it doesn't feed and stuff. But as long as I'm aware of all of that, and I feed it the right ammo, and I'm aware that the stock might do that, and I make sure that I tighten this up every so often, it's great. But that is like the Rolls Royce of pumps.
Oh, yeah.
It really is. It's better engineered, I would say, than a Mossberg 500. It really is very nicely engineered.
Yeah, something about the Mossberg, though. We were talking about this before we, obviously it's clear.
Yeah.
Talking about this before we made the video, how that's obviously so much, much better technically than a Mossberg. But there's something about the Mossberg. And every shooter I've spoken to, who've got loads of guns, like many times more than we've got, they all still got a Mossberg 500. There's just something about them, but I don't know if I'll do that. I might sell that for cabinet space, possibly.
What this?
No, not that.
No, the Mossberg
500.
I was
but I think I fear it's one of those things I will regret forever.
Yeah.
And end up buying it.
But yes, this is a lovely, lovely gun, and I'm actually very tempted now. I've actually played with this a bit to get one. I've handled these before, but this one's been broken in. When I used one of these before in a competition, it was a little bit stiff. But
yeah, I remember that. He just bought it, hadn't he? Like very kindly lent it to us before when we were probationers to have a go.
And it did feel quite uncomfortable. But this, now it's broken in, this is beautiful.
Mm.
I mean, maybe that's more of a reason to buy one secondhand. You save some money, and it's already broken in.
And it's a 3.5-inch chamber as well, which I don't know if I've actually ever used 3.5-inch chamber shotguns. I can't really go wildfiring with that. I'm sure I'll buy some and we'll have a bit of a go there.
It is almost pointless, actually, in a Section 1 firearm to have a 3.5-inch chamber.
Mm.
Because, you only ever use that for wildfowling, and you can't use a Section 1 for wildfowling. Or at least...
Well, you can have a Section 2 Supernova there, Samuel, remember? Well, I could potentially crimp the tube on this and restrict its capacity. But what I am going to do, I'm going to increase its capacity considerably.
Yes.
For practical, which is obviously what you can do with a gun like this.
Anyway, moving on... We've now covered all of that. Here we have my Tika T3X in 243 caliber.
New special rifle, Sam.
Yeah, which I admittedly can't hit the side of a barn with at the moment. But it is, I mean, you've seen the review. I've only done it recently, but it's a cracking rifle. It really is. You know, you've got standard 3-shot magazine. You can get bigger ones, although you shouldn't really need bigger.
Not really. Well, to be fair, you wouldn't want a big magazine on that because the ammo is so ridiculously expensive.
Well, that too.
You just blaze away through it at the range, obviously.
But it is beautiful. Beautiful wood. The quality of the action is fantastic. And I know Tika in World War II actually made a lot of the Finnish Moser & Gantz. I can't remember what they're called. That'll be M93, is it? I can't remember now, but they are like they were the Rolls Royce of Moser & Gantz. Tika didn't typically make them. Seiko normally made a lot of them in Finland, but Tika later on actually developed rifles as a defensive rifle for the military to basically prevent an invasion in subsequent years, especially through the Cold War and all of that. And obviously, after a few years, Seiko bought Tika, and now really. What you're buying is a budget Seiko, and there's nothing wrong with that because Seiko are fantastic rifles. So even though this was 970 quid, which isn't exactly cheap, is compared to a Seiko quite inexpensive. And I've topped it off with a Schmidt & Bender scope, which is very, very
nice. That's lovely, yeah.
I mean, this was 300 quid second hand. It's probably 20 odd years
old. That was a good idea though, buying that second hand.
It is beautiful, beautiful glass. And I mean, if you look at the MTC on here, this is a great scope, but it's not even remotely in the same league as this Schmidt & Bender. So I'm hoping over time I will be able to shoot this a lot better.
Oh, I'm sure you will.
One of my subscribers has actually offered me a long-range shooting lesson, so I will be taking... I can't remember your name, I'm sorry, but I will be taking up on that when I've got a minute. So I haven't forgotten. I will PM you. So that's that. Now, moving a bit further on, I suppose we've got... this bad boy, a little bit more tactical. This would be Tom's Smith & Wesson M&P 1522. I'm sure it's clear, but I'll take this flag out, which isn't the easiest thing to do, to be fair.
It's quite a long way.
Yeah. So, obviously, just like a standard AR-15, pop a mag in here, slap the side of it, chambers around, you want to drop the mag, you've got the finger, here. And it's, it's a good little gun. I must admit...
it's a lot of fun.
When I've used this in competition and in practical mini rifle, I've actually used the Predator ARX, which people don't generally rate because they haven't got a mil-spec barrel. I say mil-spec, it is a .22 long rifle, but it hasn't got a heavy barrel, and people don't generally rate them that much. But this, compared to this, I found the Beretta to be a lot better, to be honest. But, you know, you can't fault it, really. It's a functioning, fully functioning AR-15 in .22. So, yeah, I'm a
done quite a few bits and pieces to it. Since I've had that, that's another thing for me, these guns, what's so great about them? And I know that you talk about the Beretta. The Beretta is a great gun. I've shot the Beretta as well. Got our club's got one. It is a lovely little thing and it just runs smoothly.
Yeah.
But this, though, because you can buy lots of stick-on bits and go faster bits quite easily, it is a lot of fun sitting there on the internet. I normally buy stuff this on Christmas Day.
Yeah.
I must have have that trigger. A competition trigger and that extra...
AR-15s generally... I'm going to have a cigarette, apologies. This would make a good hunting rig. You know, if you shorten down the barrel to like 12 inches, so it was sort of under the handguard, got a silencer on it, you could get some sort of light setup, some night vision on it, it would be great.
Yeah, I think it would make a good little lamping gun.
Absolutely.
So it is tempting. It makes it more handy.
Yeah.
But not as reliable as a bolt, though, when you're hunting, ultimately.
Yeah.
Although this it has been very low.
It has. It's
got the stoppages on it. It was there, actually, but I think it just needs a good clean. Let's take that out and blast some out of it through there.
It's a cracking little gun, anyway. So, moving on a bit further, and we're getting towards the end of it. Again, Tom's collection is a little bit more extensive than mine.
Yes.
We have here his very beautiful...
My precious.
Shield 303.
Yes.
And, again, you've seen the review of this that I did not that long ago.
But it is a lovely, lovely thing.
Beautifully engineered. The only thing I don't like about it is the long eye relief standard scope. Well, scope. Iron sight.
They are awful to use.
More recently, Enfields will have like a sort of peep sight about here.
The number four, that is, I believe. Well, I'm not that clued up. Sam hasn't got a clue really with Enfields. I'm a bit more clued up because I've got one. And go on Facebook and look at groups. I think it was the number four that took over from the next Radical design. I think it had a heavier barrier. It certainly had better sights. And there was a couple of other differences that I'm sure everyone else will fill me in on who actually knows what they're talking about. But I have seen a sight. I've been offered a sight like a Mark V, like a target sight for it that fits.
Yeah.
From a guy at my club, I just need to try and meet up with him and grab it off him. And I reckon we could start doing some long range shooting with that.
I'm sure,
We've got some plans out this year as well, potentially.
We need to get somewhere to do it, though.
Yeah, yeah. There's a number of options we've got open to us, we've been talking about.
So. I like the fact that if you just pull the bolt up, it'll just like flick out really quickly. It's also got a magazine cut-off. So, in theory, you can stack up this magazine with 10 rounds, and then just drop them in one at a time, shoot it single shot, and then, obviously, Germans come, pull it out, and then you've got 10 shots on tap. It's also with here, you've got this bolt here, and it means you can technically decock it. What's that? You've got screws here.
Oh, I think that's always...
Okay. Anyway, you can hold this. I don't know how easily you can see that, but you can pull that back, pull the trigger, and gently drop it. And the principle, the idea was that during the war, they could walk around with it, one in the chamber, uncocked, and then they can just pull this out to cock it, and then they're ready to fire, so they don't have to like wrap the bolt. So it's a very safe way of holding it.
Ooh.
But it is a lovely piece of history.
It is.
And compared to the more subsequent Lee-Enfields that came out, it is much better engineered, because obviously once the war started, they had to start banging out rifles. And the quality went down quite considerably. Well,
the finish on it is something else. So on the sight protectors, you won't be able to see. You'll see on the other video, but just the way they're curved over nicely and sort of stippled at the end.
Yeah.
On the later ones, it's just a square, jagged piece of metal that someone's hacked up. But yeah, I'll need to get a bayonet for it.
So,
obviously,
I
found out that sling is not a period and should be leather, so I have to get one of those, I suppose, as well.
Absolutely.
But yeah, there's more stuff like to do with guns, which is expensive, but it's good fun.
So, we've covered most of it now. I told you it wouldn't take that long.
How long has it taken us so far?
I don't know.
Yeah,
I've got to have a look. But we have here Tom's Taurus 44 Magnum. And as you can see, it's, you know, standard revolver, just with a stupidly long barrel. Some of our American friends will be thinking, what the hell is that?
And what the hell is that?
And what the hell is this, especially?
The coat hanger on the back.
But this is a 12-inch barrel, and yeah, it is what it is. It means that with this 12-inch barrel, that meets the minimum requirement as a firearm, as a rifle carbine in England. And with this here, which is fixed, you know, you can't take that off, the overall length is, what, 24 inches. So this is legally a rifle, but, you know, you can still use it as a revolver. Tom does have a red dot on it.
Not a very good red dot.
It's not particularly good. And
no, it was cheap though. So
and you haven't actually
lesson learned there really
properly configured. But
I had it pretty much where I wanted it, I think, with that sight. But then it just stopped working. So I think it's going straight in the bin. I'll go back to iron sights for now, which is good fun though. Iron sights with that gun.
It is,
to be honest with you. And that one actually wasn't that bad for doing competitions.
Yeah, I'm trying to think how to hold this, because obviously if this was a self-loading rifle, you'd be like this, a self-loading pistol, you'd be like this.
But yeah, but,
don't want to do that with a revolver, really, so you sort of, whatever. But, and then you've got double action. It's a great gun, and the 44 Magnum is, yeah, it's a bit of a handful, but this, it's not too bad. Do you want to have a look?
Well, it is a heavy gun, to be fair.
So because it's so heavy, it really does handle the recoil very well. So,
although my accuracy with 44 actual hot magnum rounds isn't very good, so they're just a bit of fun really. I've got shoot 44 special through it, mostly for competitions. But even that, everyone who shoots the competition reload just saying that's what a stupidly high load you're putting through it for competitions. You just need to put it all through a piece of paper.
Yeah.
So, in hindsight, possibly a 357 might have been a better choice, because I believe the version of that is a smaller frame and 7 shots as well, which in a competition I would have thought it would be an advantage, but I still enjoy shooting it massively. It's one of those guns you can sit in the cabinet for a couple of months and you get it out and you got a big grin straight away as soon as you load it up.
It's not cheap loaders.
It wasn't cheap, no, but I sort of justified the man maths that someone told me that you won't be able to buy one ever again. So I bought one, and then shortly after that, they decided, yes, you can buy them again in this country brand new. So
I think that was a marketing thing.
Oh, of course it was. It was all load of rubbish. But it means I'm now the owner of a gun.
So but it's funny, though, because if you look at it from an American perspective, you're going to be like, well, yeah, it's a Taurus. And yeah, it's like...
Probably, I don't think it's that badly made
those. Yeah, but you haven't handled a nice Smith & Wesson.
No, I haven't. I'm bloody buying
one. Because in England, we're just like, oh, yeah, this is a revolver. It's really nice. And it's like... It's only because that's the only one we can have.
Yeah.
But I'm sure our American friends will tell us, well, no, that's like some horrible Mexican...
We should go abroad and shoot some proper handguns, really.
We should,
really. Places in France do it, though, apparently.
Yeah.
As if started to prop up now. I've noticed one or two extra ones.
There is a guy on the Rack and Load shooting group who's supposedly setting up some sort of range for English people, which is a reasonable distance from the Channel. So... That would be good, because, you know, when I go to France, there are places I could shoot, but unfortunately, the language barrier is a bit of a problem.
Yeah, well, perhaps we should get our fingers out and start to learn to speak French, but difficult.
You can't do that in 5 minutes, can you?
No, unfortunately not. But I've seen other places as well that do World War II stuff, and they've also got, recently, you can shoot full auto. And they've got AKs, I think they've got an MG34 as well, which I would like to have a go with. They've got things like old Lee Enfield, number 4T snipers, Garand, and a few other like submachine guns, I believe. I've been looking at that, but I think that's in the Dordogne, which I think is quite far south. But we should sort something out, I think, really. Yeah. On a broad trip.
Count English Shooting does a lot of...
He does, yeah. I don't know how,
doesn't he?
How good the video's going to be. We do the video, obviously, because it's us going shooting, but... more for our enjoyment than anything, but...
Well, no, you saw that with Callum's videos. We did some good videos, but the thing is, and I'm sure he would agree, is that, you know, he's there to sort of have some fun shooting.
Yes.
And obviously, you can't tell everyone else to shut up and stop shooting while you film and whatever, so, you know, there's only so far you can go with making a really good video. You know, you can't do a sort of Conan Noir thing with those close-ups of the mag dropping out and, like, looking all cinematic. It's quite...
It's so restricted for shooting in Europe compared to the States. Mm. You know, in this country compared to the States, definitely. Even though we have got licenses and we own these, we can take them home, there's so few places we can actually shoot them.
Yeah.
Especially to get somewhere with privacy and the right conditions we need to
film.
Well,
that's why we're lucky though with the our club, because the only disadvantage, of course, is we've only got 50 metres. But you can shoot pretty much anything. I mean, up to a 338 Lampeur.
I think so, yeah.
I don't think you can shoot a 50 BMG there, can you?
I don't think so, no. But even though I think personally it'd be safe, but a bit pointless at 50 metres.
50 metres for 50 BMG. Well, people do though, people do. There's like from Demolition Ranch, they're actually about to do a video on the 50 BMG because one of the guys there's just bought one, but he's got another channel, I can't remember what it's called, Off the Ranch or something, and he's been talking about that, and he was zeroing that rifle at about 60 metres.
Really?
Yeah.
50 BMG? But then with that would shoot flat four, well, flat or flat, but be accurate out
too. To be honest, I think it's one of those guns where as long as, you know, it's almost any range, you just zero it, you're at the same point a mile away, probably. But anyway, so yeah, I hope you enjoyed that.
Mm.
Just to assure you guys, there is no ammunition in this room.
No,
in this building, because we're not actually even in the house. We're in a outbuilding at the moment, and this took a lot of setting up to build.
Shed.
But for safety reasons, obviously, everything's checked, everything's cleared, all ammo is in
multiple
a separate location. And we will at some point sort of do this again, I suppose, with different types of ammo, just to have a bit of a talk about that. But obviously, with us faffing with them and looking at them and dry firing them occasionally, we didn't want to have any ammo anywhere in the vicinity. So don't worry.
Obviously,
about
we wouldn't be stupid enough to load a gun in the house
Obviously, but you don't even want it in the same location.
If anyone ever called us into disrepute our safety, obviously there's no one behind the camera.
No, just say we're worried about that.
In this building.
It's all clear, it's all cool. You know, we may do a few more videos like this. This is like a
test, isn't it? For both of us on camera at the same time.
Let's be honest, it's a bit of a rip-off of a Iraq War veteran, because he does these sorts of
things. But he makes some damn good videos.
Yeah, he does. I'm sure Eric isn't watching, but if he ever does watch, take it as a compliment.
Yeah, we love your videos, definitely.
So there we are. There'll be more of this to come. Keep watching.